In this section of the book, they're looking at some different representations of chemical formulas, as well as other things like isomers and molecular versus empirical formulas. So those are some of the things that we want to take a look at here. So first thing we want to talk about is different representations of chemical formulas. So here we have CH4, which is methane. It's about 85% of natural gas. So natural gas is about 85% methane. And methane is a carbon bonded to four hydrogens. This is called a molecular formula and is extremely common in chemistry. B is also CH4. You see a carbon and four hydrogens, but you'll see it gives you a little bit more information. It tells you how the atoms are bonded. The hydrogens aren't bonded to the hydrogens. All of the hydrogens are bonded to the carbon. This is called a structural formula and sometimes called a Lewis structure. And we'll talk about these a lot more later on in the course. There's also ball and stick models, where the middle ball is a carbon and the sticks, if you will, to the other smaller balls are hydrogens. So the small one is hydrogen, the bigger one is carbon. This gives you more information than this, because now you can see kind of the three-dimensional shape of this molecule. And then finally, there is this representation, which is called the space-filling model of methane. These surfaces are the electron clouds. This is probably the closest to what it would look like in real life if one could see the electron clouds. So this gives us several different models. But what's important to remember is these are all methane. Now, in chemistry classes, this is the most common. And in some chapters in this course, we'll use this one a lot. But we rarely use these for the obvious reason that they're difficult to draw. But you could imagine if you were, for example, working for a drug manufacturer and you were trying to develop a drug that would fit into an enzyme, a space-filling model would be very important to see if your drug could actually fit. So these are very important and useful because they give us more information. However, again, because you basically need computers to draw them, we usually stick to these ones. And specifically for the beginning of this course, we mostly stick to this molecular formula. Finally, again, one last time, these are all representations of methane, the same thing. Here's just another example with S8. So S8 is the molecular formula. Here you could see a structural formula. This isn't exactly a Lewis structure because it's missing lone pairs. Here you can see a ball and stick model, and here you can see a space filling model. This is all just the same thing. Another way that atoms are represented is using different types of space filling models like this. So this represents one hydrogen atom. This is two hydrogen atoms. This is one hydrogen molecule because it's diatomic, so hydrogen naturally bonds to itself. And this is two hydrogen molecules. So in Alex, for example, the homework, you may see these different representations of atoms. And it's important to understand what the differences are. Note that an atom is found on the periodic table, and a molecule is two or more atoms combined. This is called a hydrogen, which is diatomic, which means it comes in pairs, is called what's called a diatomic element. Here's another example that's a little bit different. You'll notice here, this is titanium dioxide, which is used in sunblocks. It's used to make paint and toothpaste very bright white. It's often used as a pigment or again in sunblock. And you'll notice this is very different. There's a lot going on here. When we saw hydrogen, it's one hydrogen bonded to another. But in this case of titanium dioxide, it's this lattice. So if you look at the ratio, the gray ball is titanium and the blue ball, or excuse me, the red ball, are oxygen. You'll notice that the ratio of titanium to oxygen is one titanium for every two oxygens. But there's lots of titaniums and lots of oxygens. And this is what's called a lattice. And as you'll learn a little bit later in this course, and even the beginnings of which are later in this chapter, is that this is an ionic compound, which contains a metal and a non-metal. And ionic compounds exist in lattices. And the formulas that we give for ionic compounds are the simplest ratio of the atoms. So we don't want to count all the titaniums. I don't know how many are on this picture, but you can imagine this is just a small amount of a crystal chunk of titanium dioxide. We don't want to make it titanium 4 billion, oxygen 8 billion. So instead, we give the simplest ratio, which is TiO2. And again, it's just a ratio between the two atoms. Finally, there's one other thing we want to look at, and this is benzene. Benzene's molecular formula is C6H6. So this is the Lewis structure, or the structural formula of benzene, the ball and stick model, and the space filling model. But what's important to note is there's a whole other thing going on here, which is the macro level of benzene. This is what benzene looks like. If you were to go to a lab that had benzene in it and ask for some benzene and they give it to you in a small bottle, this is what you would get. Notice that this clear liquid doesn't really give you an indication of these structural formulas. So there's also physical properties, such as benzene being a clear liquid, that are not easily deduced from these formulas. But they do also exist, right? So benzene being a clear liquid makes it a good solvent. Benzene is known to cause cancer, so it's used less now than it has been in the past, but it is still a solvent that you can find in most organic research labs, if not other types of research labs. So it is used. People do need to know what it looks like. And basically, this is very different from the chemical structural formulas. Later on, as you get more familiar with chemistry, this structure will give you some indication that potentially this is a liquid at room temperature, something about its intermolecular forces and things like that. But they're certainly well beyond the scope of not only this this chapter, but also General Chemistry 1 in general. So these things come into play, at least here, in General Chemistry 2. One other thing that I want to point out that comes up a lot in organic chemistry, and organic chemistry is carbon-based chemistry, it doesn't come up super often in general chemistry, is isomers. So isomers are molecules that have the same molecular formula, but a different arrangement in space. And there are many types of isomers. What we're seeing here are called structural isomers. So if you look here, acetic acid, which is found in vinegar, and methyl formate are both C2H4O2. But in the case of acetic acid, you have two carbons bonded to each other, one carbon double bonded to an oxygen, and it's also bonded to a second oxygen. So this carbon is bonded to two oxygens, one of which is an OH and one of which is a double bond. Here we have a carbon bonded to an oxygen, bonded to a carbon, which is double bonded to an oxygen. These are different arrangements of atoms. Here you have the two carbons connected. Here the two carbons are not connected. But they're both C2H4O2. This makes them what are called structural isomers. And as I mentioned a minute ago, there are many other types of isomers. And in organic chemistry, an entire chapter, if not more, depending on which book you're using, is devoted to different types of isomers, including structural isomers like these. The final thing that we want to talk about here is the introduction to empirical formulas. And in the next chapter, when we talk about masses and moles and things like that, one of the things you can find from this information is the empirical formula. Empirical formula is the simplest ratio of moles in an atom. And if you decompose a molecule into its atoms and you measure the masses of the atoms that you find when you do the decomposition, you can usually only find the empirical formula, the ratio of the moles. You can't actually know the molecular formula without often some kind of more sophisticated technique. So if we look here, we have C6H6, which is benzene, which we already talked about. You'll notice that there's a common denominator. They're both 6. So if you were to decompose this into carbon and hydrogen, probably you would burn it into carbon dioxide and water and then subtract out the mass of the water, but or the oxygen. But anyway, if you were to decompose this, you would find that the ratio of carbon to hydrogen is 1 mole of carbon to 1 mole of hydrogen. Said another way, there's a common denominator. These are both 6, so we divide both by 6 to find the empirical formula. If we look at N2O4, in this case, the common denominator is 2. Because 2 divided by 2 is 1, and 4 divided by 2 is 2. So if you were to find the empirical formula of this, you would find it's NO2. Both of these numbers are divided by 2. So this is the simplest ratio between nitrogen and oxygen. If you look at water, for example, H2O, the empirical formula of water is also H2O because there's no common denominator between the 2 and the 1. So therefore, this already is the simplest ratio, whole number ratio of moles. So you can't divide further. So in some cases, the molecular formula and the empirical formula are the same. Let's look at one last example, which is glucose, C6H12O6. You'll notice the common denominator is here. 6, of course, goes into 6, and 6 also goes into 12. So you divide them all by 6, you get C1, 12 divided by 6 is 2, and 6 divided by 6 is 1, and this is the empirical formula. Again, empirical formulas are necessary sometimes because if you only know the masses of the elements that form these things, the best you can do is find the empirical formula, which is the simplest whole number ratio of moles. Then other work might need to be done in order to determine the molecular formula.